So, hello Nicholas.
Hello, Melanie.
It's a really exciting day today because I've been given the opportunity to put you on your casting couch. Oh
But that's later.
So, hello and welcome. Today it's my turn, Melanie Mortiboys, to interview Dr Nicholas Beecroft. A consultant psychiatrist exploring the future of Western civilization through a series of interviews with visionary leaders. It was just over 6 months ago that I first interviewed Nicholas at the start of his project when he was saying what his mission and what he wanted to do with the project. And now it's time to take stock and really evaluate what's happened and put Nicholas on the chair too, I think. Hello, Nicholas.
Hello, Melanie.
Lovely to have turned the tables and it's a really exciting opportunity for me to ask you some important questions that maybe your followers and your viewers of your interviews would also like to ask. How do you feel after this amount of time where you are right now and what you've achieved?
Well, it's been an incredibly exciting project, really interesting. Since I got going in, kind of got off to a slow start, probably a bit earlier than September, at the beginning of 2011, but really got going in 2011. And I think I just kicked into action going down to St Paul's Cathedral to interview the people at the Occupy protest. And really, since then, it's taken on a momentum of its own. And, had a great time, really. Lots of fun, met lots of very, very interesting people, and lots more ahead.
Well, yeah, it is very, very exciting, and I just like to just go backtrack slightly and just really ask what made you, well, what's your purpose behind it? Why did you start such a mission that for some might seem impossible because to analyze the future of Western civilization and try and inspire hope and show people what's on offer rather than just watching the news at 10 o'clock and see all the pain, the misery, and feel I can't do anything, I don't know how to cope. You're offering opportunity, wisdom, insight, humor, different angles that some may or may not agree with.
Well, you've answered the question for me by the sound of it. I think I don't know. Rewind to my childhood and growing up period in the 70s and the 80s. It was a very depressing time, really. A time of I perceived it as a time of decay, everything falling apart, old structures failing. And I could kind of feel it viscerally around me, and I really didn't like that. I think, as you rightly say, if we listen to the news, or if you listen to the radio or read a newspaper, we're bombarded with negativity. There's a huge long list of potential disaster zones and terrible things that may happen and are happening, and so on. And that all feels really heavy and weighty. And I think, really, I suppose I've been on a journey to try to work out a positive way forward, as simple as that, really. And a few years ago, I realized that actually it isn't as bad as the media are making out. The media naturally goes for negative information, negative threat-based information, because we're designed to be alert to that kind of sex, food, and threat. A pretty important stimuli. And however, if you kind of look at things, it's not those things aren't true, but to look at them from a different angle, actually, we are in the most amazing time going. All of the things about modernity, the growth of science, the growth in our culture, the growth in human potential is just getting faster and faster and faster. More technology, more ideas, people all over the world are experimenting with different ways of doing things, new initiatives. And sure, there are those problems, but really the pace of human learning and the pace of change, because of the internet, because of travel, because of the way that we're able to communicate now, is infinitely fast. So just as the threats are huge, the opportunities are vast. And the aim of the project really was to begin to connect with many of those visionary leaders and entrepreneurs who are doing exciting things, new initiatives, or people who can really tell the positive story of who we are and where we're going. The aim was to draw them together and give them a platform to share those stories, and also to dig down and test them out a bit to see how practical they are, to see where they're working, really as a resource to share, to inspire people, and as you say, to bring hope to those who are feeling hopeless and negative. To play my role in our global conscious evolution.
Mm. Who do you find are your main followers and lookers at the videos?
Well, 16,000 people have watched them on YouTube. Roughly the same amount have listened on iTunes or other downloads or direct on the website. The statistics are that I suppose about 60% are male, 40% female. The majority are between 25 and 65. Well, I suppose the majority of the population, but weighted probably from about 30 to 65 is the biggest group. Particularly in the English-speaking countries, so Britain, America, Australia, Canada, New Zealand, and also closely aligned countries within the West, so Germany, Holland, Sweden, and so on. And really a scattering of people elsewhere. From the people that I directly have contact with, lots of people who, if you like, resonate with that way of thinking. So a combination of people who are visionary leaders and doing innovative, evolutionary type work. Also people who've been feeling a lot of frustration and hopelessness and are interested to listen to people who've got a positive way forward.
How do you foresee it going further now? What are your dreams for your own project?
I think the part of it that will carry on as it is, there are many more subjects that I'd like to cover. I'm going to be talking to some people about masculinity, femininity, and how they relate to community. I'm going to be talking to an interesting pair who've done some work on transpartisan politics. Going to be talking to a lady who uses music to really inspire and integrate people. I'd like to find someone who can talk about authority and the way that that is evolving, about the way that our cultural boundaries operate, what is a healthy boundary. I've got a really great speaker coming up, a lady from Birmingham who's done some really interesting work on inspiring black people to integrate and to really get involved in the democratic process. I would really like to, I haven't found someone, I'd like to find someone who could talk about energy security as well as energy sustainability, because both of those tend to be separate, and my feeling is they should come together. I've got a great speaker on love and sex, and there's going to be a speaker coming up on integrating sexual diversity into the way that we live. Someone's going to be talking about parenting and sort of healthy inspiration and human potential and boundaries in that context.
Fantastic, right? That's really, really exciting. But I was asking, because I kind of know through the pipeline that you are writing a book, and I'm just curious to know a bit more about that.
I see. Yeah. Well, in a way, I chose this format because partly as a psychiatrist, but also just as a person generally, I seem to get my most creative space, my best thinking space and creative space in relation to others, particularly in a dialogue. So this is my natural, most easy format, really. But yeah, there's a job going on in the background to really integrate and synthesize the lessons and the observations from this project. The book is really to integrate the lessons of coming from these interviews, but also grounded in the work that I've done over the years. My aim for that is that will be a book which will, it's pretty insanely megalomaniac in its breadth, but the aim is to really put Western civilization on the psychiatrist's couch.
Mm.
What I did for the British-Syrian relationship, for example, or the war on terror. And the aim is, you know, who are we? Where are we going? What's our identity? And how are we, what's the vision and the values and the future around which we're aligning ourselves? What are the wounds that need healing? Where is our energy flowing? The boundaries, the truth and the falsehood, the conflicts and so on. And of course, then to make some suggestions as to, no one person has the answers, absolutely not. But of course, I will have my own opinion and give some suggestions as ways forward in terms of principles or vision and so on.
And exciting.
Then the aim will be to share that, and I suppose go around and speak about that. And my intention will be to have some group processes where people come to listen, but also to participate. So some both focused on groups, on companies, on political associations and members of the public, to really help draw them in as to what is their role in the big picture. What is the big picture? What's the map? To align and calibrate their compass and to align their own mission and energy with their place in that.
Fantastic, how exciting. So what has been your biggest lesson so far from your project?
I think the biggest picture one is that I feel a lot more optimistic than I did when I started. I've met both directly in the interviews, but also all the people who contacted me privately, a lot of very positive people doing amazing work. And those are not kind of unrealistic, naive people who, you know, live in la-la land and are not connect, don't see the problems that there are in the world. But they're people who see those, but are really can see a way forward. And that's given me a huge optimism, really. I think things, or in spite of all the many disaster scenarios that could occur, I think things are going to be okay, and much better than okay, actually. I think a lot of optimism for the future, notwithstanding the huge risks that might happen if we don't sort ourselves out.
And what have been your main highlights so far?
The interview with Neil Howe on generations I found particularly it helped me place myself in the map in a way that I hadn't done before. He's done some very interesting work on looking at the cycling of generations, not just within our own lifetime, but actually going back 500 years and spotting the patterns. And that is fascinating. I instantly could see how I slotted in, you know, into the, as he calls it, the nomad generation, who were born in the 70s, when the previous generation, the baby boomer generation, had torn everything up and torn up all the rule books and were sort of pulling all the structures down, which had been created in turn by the hero generation of the Second World War. And I think realizing the way he described it and seeing the historical perspective of that made me realize that we'll feel less alone, I suppose, in that, you know, that's the way it was. And but also very positively seeing the way forward, that actually we're now going into an incredible, as he calls it, a fourth turning, but a real phase of transition where everything's up in the air, all the rules are up in the air, and the world will be remade by a new emerging hero generation. And the job of us who are a bit older is to help steward that process. So that was one highlight. I mean, too many others to mention, really. The work of Don Beck is in Spiral Dynamics runs throughout the series. I mean, he's a great visionary and someone who likewise has done incredible work in showing the cultural evolution that we're going through and how we sit in that. And again, having a framework that lets us get beyond worrying about the negative stuff and seeing the journey that we're on. And actually, another highlight most certainly was with a chap called Martin Root, who
Heaven on Earth.
Yeah, Project Heaven on Earth. And at first I cringe at that terminology because not being religious, it sounds creepy and religious. And in Britain, we don't, as Tony Blair said, we don't do religion. But actually what he meant was, he means actually that, but what he's getting at is the huge power and unleashing of potential that comes from asking ourselves the question, not what are all the things you hate and don't like and what are all the problems and what are all the challenges, but what kind of a world would you like in the best, you know, heaven on earth? What is the best possible outcome? And I resonated with that because I found that in my own experience that I'd given an awful lot of energy to fighting things that I didn't like political correctness or multiculturalism or the machine model of management and so on, and of course that just makes those forces fight back much harder and become more powerful.
So let me interrupt there and ask you what would your heaven on earth be, Nicholas? It's an appropriate time to ask.
I've got to walk my talk.
What's your vision?
Walk Martin, heaven on earth. Top line is the maximization of human potential, which sounds a bit theoretical, but that really means that me, you, everyone around us, everyone on earth, is we act and live in a way and create structures, whether it be education, health, military, etc., to create the best platform for us all to be the best and unfold, blossom in our lives as much as we can be, whether as teachers, as parents, as nurses, as entrepreneurs, and so on. A world like that, a world of freedom, a world of opportunity, which is safe, secure, and very, with lots of love. Not a naive world, a world that has strong boundaries, a world that has safe boundaries and security as well. Discipline, authority, and so on.
So why do you think we live in a world where people don't maximise their full potential?
I'd say that it'd be easy to list a long list of negatives, but, you know, we are where we are. Everyone is born into the environment in which they find themselves and they learn through their experiences. And why is that process not faster? Well, to a degree, learning goes at its own pace. So just as we all learn in our own lives, our cultures, our institutions and our ways of doing things learn. And what holds them back? Well, fear. Fear holds people back, although fear can be appropriate. All of us both as individuals and as a group, have wounds. You know, we have traumas that we've had in our lives, sometimes big traumas that are, you know, very heavy duty, and other, but certainly lots of rather smaller ones, like being shamed at school, or, you know, being worried what people think about you, and so on. And I think all of those hold us back. Sometimes we have limiting beliefs. For example, you know, in economics, a lot of people are held back by thinking that there's just one pie that has to be cut up and shared out, and so people spend all their time fighting over how big their slice of the cake is, rather than realizing that actually we can just make the cake a lot bigger.
I've always had this, I was once on a Tony Robbins seminar, and this quote that he said has always stayed with me, and I think it's really accurate in what you've just said. And he had a story that there were two sons, and one was hugely successful, happy, had a fantastic life, and the other son was a complete dropout, hadn't maximized his potential, wasn't working, wasn't flourishing, growing. And that he asked them both separately, what is the reason for the way you are? And they both gave the same answer and said their father. And so you know, that I've always loved that story, because it's empowering to know that it's yourself, rather than, you know, the victim mentality, or I've had this or this happened to me, or whatever. And that's why I like your project so much as well. You know, it's an empowering, it's about empowering people. But if it is about, underneath it all, it's about self-worth and the future of Western civilization, or the whole global civilization is about self-worth. We you know, how do we get to the core of valuing ourselves and therefore our planet?
Wow, that's an enormous question.
Cup of tea.
How do we get? Say the question again. How do we get to?
How do we get to the point where we? I see the relationship of that story that I just said is about self-worth and self-value, and if we value ourselves, we value everything outside ourselves. To create, we want to live in a place that is thriving and alive, because we have that sense of ourselves. So how do we get to that point?
I think there's two answers. I think there's going within to directly experience one's being, so not the ego mind or the neurotic thoughts or the worries or the logical mind, but directly experience the being, the one who is in the energy that is in the body, and through that direct awareness, read one's intuition. That's the inner compass. Who am I? Where are we going? How do I sense things? How do I know what's right and wrong? How do I read the energy of myself and others, of ideas, and know what to go with? How do I make judgments? It's like the, so what one is really upregulating and calibrating that inner compass, and actually three parts. The other part is knowing the map. So knowing the environment that we're in by using our full senses, using all of that intuition, all that I just described, but focused outwards in connection with others, interconnection with others, as through relating, through as parents, as children, as a doctor, as a person in a shop, as a person in a company, as a member of a country, as just someone together in relation to others. And obviously, absolutely, the logical mind of listening, thinking, knowing, learning, and, you know, being aware of our formal structures. And, yeah, that last bit, in connection with others, really. It's we are both an individual and part of a whole living system. So having our awareness turned inwards and outwards. And I suppose to answer your question, and in doing that, we will naturally be drawn energetically, positively towards, I suppose, different levels of things at a base level, desires and lusts and hungers and cravings, and some of which are, you know, and we use our judgment as to whether those are good for us or not, and desirable or not. And at the higher level, it depends on people's situation, obviously. I mean, if you're seriously ill, or if you're in a famine situation, or if you're in a, you know, working desperately to make the bills, you know, pay the bills, you can have a different set of values and a different outlook to someone who's in my situation or your situation. But basically, people will find their own level appropriate to their own situation and go with what's right for them. Also, on the negative side, you feel pain, you feel things you don't like, things that create fear or things that create suffering. And then we have a desire to either avoid those or, where appropriate, to heal them or integrate them or solve them, etc. And then at the highest level, we tap into our inspiration, our positive vision, the heaven on earth stuff, the unleashing of our full potential.
I agree fully, but I think there's one side also that I know you do a lot of work, brilliant work on, is that with the vision, there's always, well, it's not always, but it seems more often enough, there's always a shadow side to people's vision that might be pulling them down, might be, you know, self-sabotage, self-suicide, or even just a bit of distraction, or which can lead away from people's vision, and they might find it more exciting to live a more shadowy and an edge with shadow that's got all sorts of devil enticements to sort of say, come over here. It's much more exciting, and again, like you say, it could be, you know, through trauma or, you know, learned behaviour or whatever, that they've got into their shadow mission, as opposed to their vision of heaven. And that's very, you know, what do you do with that?
There's a one-word answer. It's integration, basically. You know, I'm certainly very familiar with that myself, both as an individual and in those I relate to, and in our culture as a whole. And the term comes from the sort of Jungian idea that there are parts of ourselves that of which we are fully aware, or bits of ourselves that are driving the ship, so to speak, and then there are parts of ourselves either which we're not aware of, or which we are aware of and want to suppress or avoid or whatever, and so they're pushed down out of the light into the shadow. And essentially, the therapy answer, and I think the leadership answer, is the self-leadership answer, is to make sure you're in a safe space and well supported, and then from that place to shine the light on those parts, and through whatever techniques you might use, for example, voice dialogue technique, but there'd be thousands that you could choose, to bring light to those. And because in the shadow stuff, I mean, it could be alcohol, it could be gambling, it could be crime, it could be having an affair, it could be having a sort of a lust for wars, or hoarding money, or, you know, or it could be very commonly an entitlement mentality or a victim mentality, and so on. Basically, the aim is to bring the light to those, bring awareness to those, get into dialogue with those internally. Or of course, on a group level, you'd be doing it at a group level, which is partly the aim of this project. And there's a kind of a natural healing, really, that goes on. It's not a quick fix. It's a deep, can't really summarize it quickly. It's a deep, deep bit of work. So, for example, on a group level, in our national shadow, you know, if you like, we've got the British mentality. We've got great patriotism and pride in our history and who we've been as a tribe, who we are as a tribe, what our role is, all the amazing things our ancestors have done and what a dynamic, vibrant place we live in. But there is a dark side to it as well. There's been, as in all humanity, there's been exploitation, there's been inequality, there's been racism, there's been social class inequality, there's been, you know, slavery, abuse of others, abuse of power, and of course, as there are in all cultures. And so there's that dark side. Now, what we tend to do is polarize it, and people will either go with one or the other. So they'll either just be very patriotic in a, just like in a individual's self-esteem, you know, kind of take pride in the positive stuff and deny or push away the negative. Or more commonly in our culture, people identify with the negative and list all the things that they hate about being British and all the reasons that we're bad and everything that's bad about our history and so on, and kind of revel in that in a kind of a almost like a self-harming or suicidal type way. And then they project the good things onto others and falsely, naively identify with the other, which is one of the pathologies of multicultural ideology. And so the healthy way forward is really to get it all out on the table, you know, all the warts and all, and integrate them healthily, really. It's a process of dialogue. It's a process of healing. It's a process of judgment and of non-judgment, depending on the context, and of leadership, really, individual and collective.
Well, as you were speaking that, I was imagining, well, obviously it's almost like Britain was like a little person that, you know, with its own little mind. And I just, as you're more, it's more about the future of Western civilization. So if you imagine Western civilization being embodied in a person and your PA says on the phone, excuse me, Dr. Beecroft, we have an emergency appointment for Mr. or Mrs. Western civilization, and he or she comes shuffling in, he needs emergency treatment. What would you say the state of Western civilization, as a mind, body, and soul is right now? Your big picture, right here and now.
Wow, that's a fantastic question. That's really good. That's really funny. Okay. I think it must have multiple personality disorder. Because there are lots of different selves, all with different parts that don't necessarily communicate and not very integrated, I would say. So there'd be, there'd be that self-loathing part that I've just referred to, you know, everything is bad, everything's falling apart. Well, I suppose that would be the fear-based one. So the fear state of everything's terrible, you know, the economy's in trouble, we're running out of resources, we're abusing the planet, there's so much inequality, lack of social mobility, we've still got racism, we've got uncontrolled immigration with all the sort of consequences of that. We've got a kind of an Islamic fundamentalist insurrection globally, which is trying to take over. We've got kind of lots of other countries coming up, which is great for them, but it's kind of very risky because they won't necessarily share our way of life or our views, and they might take us to a rather darker place, like the Chinese taking over, recolonizing the world as they are in Africa and South America. The Russians kind of operating more at a sort of nationalist and gangster level, and so on. you could say, oh my God, we're going to run out. Anyway, so there's that. I could go on, you know, I was getting into that state talking about it. So there's the fear state. And I would say that as part of that, there's an awful lot of people who like to think of themselves as, you know, on this sort of culture war thing, the liberals versus, or the left versus the conservatives. And I'd say a lot on the liberal left like to think of themselves as in the happy camp. But actually, that's not true. They will listen to the conservative camp who will say, oh, there's crime, there's immigration problems, there's da 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 da. But they have their own list of negatives, a very long list of negatives. And they also have a massive shadow side, including shadow racism on the left and in the liberal mentality. So no one escapes that. We all have that part. There's clearly the part which is still doing entrepreneurialism and capitalism absolutely dynamically, and that would have subparts. It'd have a healthy part that's saying, you know, it'd have the unhealthy part, which would be more of the old sort of selfish, abusing, planet destroying, human exploiting, greedy, lying, cheating, entitled parts, which have got us into some of the troubles we've got at the moment. But I think we can forcefully focus on that and say it's all wrong, it's all bad. Well, there's a really healthy part. You know, capitalism is an amazing, amazing sort of force that unleashes human potential. And in places where it's well developed and well supported and well directed, it can serve any form of human potential really very, very well. I think we've got, where have we got? We've got the masculine parts and the feminine parts in many dimensions. Both of those have gone through huge transition. I'd say the feminine part.
That's why I'm saying it. It's a Mr. or Mrs. Western civilization. I was trying to just sort of have a little character come through your door so you could just sort of see it as a whole. Because if it is a whole, we've got those little compartments, and the male and female thing is really, you know, we're always battling between male and female and that integration. So I don't know what. I don't know what sex I'd give Western civilization if it's Mr. or Mrs.
I think a lot of people would reflexly say it's masculine. That's like the new age or the more trendy way to talk about it. And the classic is, I think there are two levels on which people would say that. One would be, if you like, the feminist interpretation that, oh, you know, the world used to be patriarchal, fully male dominated. Of course, some would say it still is. And, you know, the masculine has dominated the feminine, and the masculine has been, and you know, abusing the feminine. And now we're going through a phase of empowering the female and balancing that.
Well, I think also that the feminine has been abusing the male. I mean, there's been a whole you know, the whole imbalance of male and female is, I think, vital to Western, the future of Western civilization. And I think, you know, empowerment is just accepting who you are, you know, whatever sex you are, and that it's good to be different, and that we work well together. The reason I was saying Mr. or Mrs. Western civilization was because, you know, there's always a battle between male or female, but we really need to be integrated as one, and, you know, stop fighting each other and embrace our uniqueness and how we complement each other, in my opinion, and work together. And if a man and woman, you know, can theoretically work together, then the whole planet, male and female, you know, it's about giving, receiving. It's a balance of combination, isn't it? That's vital for growth and maximizing the potential, like you say. So how will that? How do you see that?
Okay, so we haven't just got the man and woman on the couch, but we've got a whole room full of people, including all the children and including elders and so on. The best description that I've heard, the description that I like the most about it is comes from a description of, if you like, traditional man, as in his healthy form, is strong, powerful, protective, decisive, go-getting, risk-taking, bold, sexy, embodied, warrior, and in his unhealthy form, abusive, destructive, prone to being isolated, prone to addiction, prone to being sexually abusive, disrespecting the environment, the planet, and so on. And then, if you like, that's traditional man. And then there's new man, who's kind of been around more prominently since the 60s, but would have, you know, gone back longer. And in his healthy form, he is kind of sensitive and spiritual and connected and in touch with the feminine, consensus seeking, and kind of open to women. And in his unhealthy form, is weak, indecisive, unable to defend himself, not sexy, kind of wimpy, really. And so there's like the healthy, positive and negative of those. And then there's the female equivalent. So of the traditional woman being the traditional feminine being very loving, very caring, very kind, very maternal, very supportive, very interconnecting, very nurturing. And then in her unhealthy form, kind of passive, weak, under the thumb, a bit victim-y, defenseless, kind of maybe manipulative, maybe castrating, maybe stuck in her little child, the kind of the equivalent of the male one. And and then, if you like, there's the new woman, meaning, I suppose, feminist woman, who came to escape those negative parts. And she would be in her positive, strong, bold, a lot of masculine characteristics, as strong, just as the sensitive male had the feminine characteristics. So she's embodied strong masculine characteristics of being determined, forceful, decisive, incisive, powerful, capable, and so on. And in her unhealthy form, or the sort of unhealthy feminism, really, so abusive, aggressive, castrating, hate-filled, kind of hating men, not being nurturing, not being motherly, and really just being a man in a woman's body. You can see that in a lot of career women of a certain age. And then, so if you like, that's the majority of the population in those roles. But there are some people who, and I don't pretend to be in this role myself, I think it, you know, it's something which we aspire to do at our best, is to take the healthy strands of those and integrate them into a conscious embodied self in relation to the other gender. So the third man and third woman position of being the empowered, taking the positive strength of both, really. And some people would say that, I think some people use the language of the masculine and the feminine in a kind of a mystical or spiritual sense, and they mean those kind of essences, and there's some value in that when they mean, to my view, when they mean that we've had the masculine period of the, you know, incisive, separated kind of computer mentality, and so kind of the negative masculine qualities, and we haven't had enough of the positive feminine ones. I think that's probably right. A lot of feminism has taken on the characteristics of the old masculine, and I think what we're seeing is amongst older people, amongst the most evolutionary types, the most cutting edge people, and I think also naturally, healthily emerging in the younger generations, so sort of 25 and down, they are more naturally embodying and expressing the healthy masculine and feminine at all its levels, from the sort of the child through the younger age up into their sort of wisdom elder levels. So I think there are a lot of wounds there. There's a lot of old stuff, a lot of old battles, a lot of but I think it's really going in a healthy direction, mainly because the heat's come out of the battle and people have matured. A lot of the wounds, if not healed, will simply die with the people who have them, and the new generations won't really be troubled by that. They'll have moved on. Having said that, you have to put that in cultural context, because of course a lot of people coming to Western civilization, either physically coming or as immigrants, or people where they're taking on Western civilization in their countries, they're not necessarily at the same stage of development in that evolution. So on a global perspective, I don't think you could say that women are free and emancipated and so on. There's a lot of very old, dark, patriarchal stuff still going on around the world.
If we carry on with the analogy of Mr. or Mrs. Western civilizations come in and you're doing your note-taking and for this mind that is coming for help, what would be at the core of it? What would be the main trauma? What needs to get right in there to really help this this mind and body?
Dehumanization.
Can you explain that more, please?
Cutting off from life, living in systems which treat us as if we are machines. I think that one of the fantastic things, I said put it positively first, you know, one of the amazing things about Western civilization is that is science and reason, and the way in which that has enabled us to understand the world in a way that, you know, has taken us light years ahead and created the technology that we're talking on, you know, and will continue to do so. It's absolutely incredible. And that part of doing that means seeing the world as separate objects, each of which has properties which can be observed and tested. And then we create theories to explain the world and then test them through experiment. And that's wonderful. I've got no criticism of that at all. But the flip side of that is that we've put our focus upon looking at things as external objects, and particularly we've biased ourselves towards thinking of things as physical things, and we've created a separation, the Descartes separation, you know, of mind and body as being separate, the dualism, and because of that we tend to think that we live in a world of objects in which we're an object separate from other people who are objects, and then a lot of the things that we have around us, like just about everything, like money, or how do you train someone to be a doctor, or our transport network, you know, those things we could look at physically, but actually 99% of it is in consciousness. It's in our mind, you know, it's in our not just individual, but collective shared mind. Anyway, so what we've done, one of the costs of that bias is that we've cut off from our inner being, and we've cut off from just the basic simplicity that we are human beings. Simple as that. We are beings and relate to each other as beings. And that's
I enjoyed Mark Walsh's your interview with Mark Walsh about disembodiment, and totally agree, you know, that that is a huge need for us to get back in our bodies to really to feel where we are now and to deal with life. We've got Mr. and Mrs. Western Civilization in one body walking into your room, and there is obviously there's that part of their mind and body that you're analysing for the future of Western civilization. And what notes would you be taking down from looking at that part of them?
So which part, sorry?
The male and female part.
If you look at our birth rates, and I'm included in this, you know, if you look at the birth rates in Western countries and also other countries that closely aligned in terms of, I suppose, industrial culture like Japan and Russia, the birth rates and China as well, actually, increasingly the sort of the middle classes in India and so on, or even Iran, basically when people industrialize and urbanize, there seems to be a collapse in the birth rate. Partly driven by economics of maybe not needing to have so many children, and also can't afford so many because, you know, in a small traditional village, the numbers probably the more the merrier. But in urban and advanced industrial life, it's very costly. But we've actually gone so far that we're having so few children that our populations are in trouble. And if you look at the white population, like the original Aboriginal populations of Europe, many of those are collapsing fast. For example, particularly the countries you'd least expect it, the very Catholic ones like Italy and Spain and Germany also. It is quite shocking collapses in the birth rates, and if those are not put right, then two major things will happen. One is that a very small number of children and young people will have to shoulder the economic and the physical burden of looking after an aging population, and just so in terms of wealth and being able to do it, that suggests our quality of life will drop significantly whilst that hump is dealt with. If it stabilizes, then, you know, in 50 years a lower world population might be a good thing in terms of resources and space, but not with it happening precipitously quickly. But also another factor is that different cultures, that process, whilst it's global, it's happening to all cultures, it's happening to cultures at different speeds. So those who first went into the Industrial Revolution and the Industrial Age and the Enlightenment and so on, such as ourselves and the other Western countries, happening first. And those that it's happening last to are those who are last to go into those phases. So that's the Middle East, the Islamic world and Africa. And there's an issue in a security point of view as to, in a sense, if all of those people take on Western civilization, or broadly democracy, freedom, education, human potential, security, respect for human rights and so on, then it's completely irrelevant what culture or race or religion people are. But if they don't, if they go down another path of Chinese nationalism or Islamic fundamentalism, or if they're just simply going at a much slower pace, then Western civilization may drop away, may evaporate, may collapse before it succeeded. why did I say all that? I mean, I think that's true. That's one of the doom-monger things at the beginning. But I think the rebalancing of the masculine and the feminine. So if you like, in a way, what's happened was with feminism and with women coming into the workplace and coming into what used to be male roles and so on, the difference between the genders have become much closer. So women have become more masculinized and more taken up the male space, and men have become more feminized, and the polarity between the two is less, because a kind of those two don't attract each other in quite the same way as the traditional masculine and the traditional feminine. And what I think I'm observing in the people I meet and around me, but from a low base, is that that's moving apart again, not back to the old traditional masculine and feminine, but to a more, if you like, the embodied goddess and the embodied god.
That'd be lovely.
In the tantric sense, are more finding their equal but different, and obviously with full diversity in between and all the different types of people there are, and anyone can be anything they like, but nevertheless, within that, broadly speaking, you know, men and women have distinctions and so on, and people are getting more comfortable with that, really. And anyway, so the point is, they're going to have more babies. So you'll see that if you look at our birth rates, the demographic graphs, you'll see that as that kicks in, Western people will have more children, and it will rebalance. That's already in Britain, you're already beginning to see some of the first signs of that, but it's from a...
I'm really excited. I was just thinking, I'm really excited to read your book. Really am. It's nice to hear your... I know you give your views on your interviews, but it's nice to actually give you the safe space and inquiry too, to listen to what you have to say. Yeah. No, I am... That's very interesting. Obviously, we could talk for hours about that, but let's move on to a bit more analysis of Western civilization on your couch. And you're obviously taking notes and analysing your patient, as it were. What can you? Is there anything intuitively that's kind of disturbing you? You know, when you get a gut feeling, like thinking, "Oh, well, there's something not quite right here." What's that?
Well, in terms of the project, I think something that you've pointed out is that my choice was to go for visionary leaders, interview visionary leaders, looking to get people who've got positive, optimistic stories of who we are, where we're going, in particular domains. And to test that practically. And my intention is very much still to do that. There's lots more to do. But I think that I've not been exploring the shadow side, the dark side, so much. That's partly because I wanted to focus on the positive and put the energy into the positive. But I think there is a rebalancing to be done to go more for that.
I think that sounds juicy.
And I think that will involve having more juicy and more controversial people to speak to, and I think probably maybe more fiery, more sparks.
Well, that sounds really really fascinating. Can you tell me a bit more how you'd like to go about doing that?
Not really, no. You can
watch this space.
You can watch and see. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, good. So, if you're looking at your Western civilization, can I just ask, why do you always just a little side time? Why do you always call it future of Western civilization? Why not future of the planet Earth civilization?
That's a great question. A lot of people have said that to me online by way of feedback. And the reason for that is the starting point I had was I suppose I grew up to be patriotically British, and we do operate on a nation state level, and so traditionally, and so the obvious place for my political mind was British and British politics and so on. But I found that when I began to look at our culture and what the things that are going on, I had this naive idea that, for example, when I was looking at the machine model of management, the way that our hospitals are run as if they were made up of, you know, cogs and spreadsheets and numbers, and as opposed to human beings, both as patients and as staff, I naively imagined that all I could do was to look round to Sweden or look to New Zealand or wherever, and there would be really dynamic people doing something very different. And what shocked me was, whether in that area or discipline in schools or taxation or anything, bizarrely, we're missing a trick. You know, we've got, well, to look at it just on a British level doesn't make sense, because we are part of a much bigger group. And of course, you could look at it as, you know, London or doctors or male doctors or London or, you know, my family or the immediate community, all of these, you know, I think the truth is it's nested, you know, we live on many levels. But I think it became clear to me that we were operating on, at the very least, the English-speaking world, meaning Britain, America, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, and those people who speak English in all the other countries, really including India, Sri Lanka, and so on. But really, it's more than that. I think the same phenomena, a lot of the same phenomena are happening throughout Europe, and really throughout the rest of the world, you know. So why not then make it, say, global? And I think, well, I expect that the future eventually, well, to a degree, we are globalizing, and we do live in a global world, and we are integrating and we're interconnecting. But we're not there yet. And I think it's, I think that will probably, unless we really mess up badly economically or militarily or whatever, you know, it is going to a global world, and that's a good thing. And eventually, the world will be one living system made up of interconnected living beings, and, you know, all the different parts of it will, you know, whether that be London or Britain or whatever, will be just like a node in the consciousness, just like a, you know, a group of birds in the bigger flock. But we'll still, but I think as we are now, there are still things which are very distinct. And for me, thinking about it just on a British level is too small. But I think to think of it on a global level, some things need to be thought of on a global level. But for example, if you talk about political correctness or multicultural ideology, that doesn't mean anything in, I don't know, in Argentina, does it? I don't know. I don't know. Maybe it does. I don't really think so. I don't think they're really at the stage of doing stuff like that. I think if you're thinking about, you know, if you're looking at what are we going to do about our economy, well, in Brazil, they don't really care. They're absolutely fine, thanks very much. You know, so there are things particular to the West. And in terms of, you know, China, for example, India, Russia, the Islamic world, we're all mixing up and interconnecting, and certainly through immigration, but we're still very distinct societies. And I wouldn't, in a way, it would be arrogant of me to pretend, you know, some people have said it's big-headed to have a project called The Future of Western Civilization, because it sounds so megalomaniac. But I think that it would be arrogant to sort of you know, I don't know a lot about Africa or China, or I mean, I know some things. I've got a healthy interest in them, and I've been there, But you know, we are still different, and we do still have a distinct consciousness and distinct values and so on. And so, very long answer, but the reason is because British is too small. You know, these processes are happening on a much bigger scale. Many processes are happening on a global scale, but on balance, I think that the West is distinct enough to talk about on that level. And I think if I just said global civilization, a lot of the things which I think we need to sort out wouldn't be of interest to elsewhere. You know, how are we going to sort out our healthcare system in Malawi? You know, they would like a healthcare system. You know, it's not, it's a different scenario. We are all humans, but we do live in different places and have particular situations and life conditions. It's not that I don't care about those people or don't think we're going global, but, you know, I'd put it the other way. I'd say that's stretching it quite far. Most traditional things have only focused on the national level or on a class-based level or a gender-based level, and so to stretch it as big as Western civilization is pretty huge.
Thank you for clarifying that. You often talk about the fractal and the living system, and that when we're in this living system, but surely we already are in a living system.
Yeah.
Sometimes when you talk about it, you say it's almost like when we get to that point. So, you know, what's going wrong that the fractal isn't working, that we're not, you know, in the complete... I know what you're trying to say is that when it's really thriving and working and connecting, that we'll just flourish and the potential is huge. But as it stands right now, it is working on some level, whether it be dysfunctional or not. So why is that?
Well, I think you're absolutely right that, yes, we are already in a living system. I'm alive and you're alive and so is everyone else. And that's right. That's right. We are not. So it already exists, but it's the shift is of being aware of it, being conscious of it, and acting as if it were true. That's the shift. So it's already true. It's being aware of it. So to make that practical, for example, at the moment I'm doing a project with an organization looking at their outcome measures, which might sound a bit dull, but traditionally they've looked at their outcome measures as if the... So it's a very human system providing a human medical service. So it's got medical staff and patients and a wider network. And the traditional way of looking at it is to treat it as if it's a machine, an object, like boxes with lines drawn between them, and sets of processes, and to measure it according to, you know, bums on seats. How many people do you see? How fast do you see them? How, you know, and very reasonably, you know, do they get better and how quickly? And that's really, that's all fine. Not wouldn't take away from that. But the problem with seeing it in a way that can be reduced to a spreadsheet is that we're missing out on what's already there, and already that team is operating with its patients and with all the other people that it serves, and there are already outcome measures embedded in the system, embedded in every relationship. So every time someone sees a patient, or every time someone from a different organization interacts with them and they provide a service to them, even if no one says it, even if no one writes it down, even no one puts a number on it, there is an authentic outcome measure integrated into that. At its most crude level, if that team did something really wrong, someone would phone up the boss and do something about it. You know, someone would, or it would hit the media, or someone in the hierarchy would say, "Oi, what's going on here?" Or a patient might report to somebody. So, you know, those are kind of negative examples, but people get praise for things. And anyway, the point is that there is a living system there, so that people are constantly, through their interactions, relating to one another. But if you have the mindset where you think of it as a machine, so here we have a structure made up of cogs, and what are their outputs, and how do we measure them as statistics, and how do we put them in a spreadsheet, that's okay, but not only that. But if you only do that, then you miss out on the huge depth and richness that there is by realizing that you've got an amazing living system made up of conscious beings constantly interacting with one another. So it's kind of a limiting belief. So I agree with you, it's not about moving to a living system, it's about getting rid of our limiting beliefs or our lack of low sights and realizing that we're in a living system. Mm. And
what are the limiting beliefs do you think the Western mind has about itself?
The first one that came to me was growth has to be about money. That's very obvious. That the way we've designed our financial system, our economic system, assumes that we have to have constant growth, more and more money, and more consumption. And the problem with that is obvious, that, you know, there's limited resources, and of course we will improve technology and we'll, you know, and so on, but there eventually is a finite limit. And one of the limiting beliefs is actually that we don't, after a certain level of material wealth, and when people are poor, they definitely need more to be happy or to be secure, no question about that. But beyond a certain level, actually, that's not the most important thing. And our belief that we need money to be happy, or that we need ever increasing material possessions, is a limiting belief. Because that isn't necessary for security or human potential or fun or love or sex or community and so on.
So as the Mr. Mrs. Civilizations on your couch and you're diagnosing it in your head and writing notes, are you giving it labels or, you know, diagnoses in from your psychiatrist's point of view?
No, I think that'd be over the top, falsely stretching the metaphor too far. No, not really.
Well, I know you're not a sort of labels kind of person what's the treatment program for? what's the journey of recovery if it needs recovery?
Yeah, great question. What is the treatment program? Well, we could dive into any specific example, I won't give an example because you'll take it, but we could dive into lots of specifics. But at the biggest picture, it's awareness and integration and healing. So bringing awareness to all the different parts, the healthy, the unhealthy, the known, the unknown, the positive, the negative, drawing together all the different strands, healing what needs to be healed, and going with what needs to be going, really getting the blocks out of the way of our human potential and really tapping into our pure energy and potential, really. That sounds a bit simplistic, but the biggest picture, that's it. Same as for an individual.
Well, it's a really hopeful and I think a picture that we're capable of.
Right.
I mean, what are the parts that the Western civilization could relapse on or get stuck into, from your point of view?
Yeah. Well, the economic situation is very precarious, partly because of the unsustainable debt situation. And partly just because for historical reasons, because the way we've developed, we're very imbalanced economically with the rest of the world. And there's going to have to be a reckoning, you know, a rebalancing, no question about that. And that could happen in a precipitous, cataclysmic way in which all of our structures fall apart. Seriously, you know, we could end up with, our whole government system's really failing, and you know, real poverty and real sickness. And of course, we don't exist in a vacuum. Other players may interact there, such as you know, the stuff that's happening in the Middle East may well spill over into Europe. You can have a lot of descent into crime and so on. So, and if all that happens, then our mindset will inevitably and necessarily shift down into security and survival. And in that, challenges of that order might be wonderful for stimulating really amazing leaps into new ways of doing things, but equally they can take you to very dark places with a lot of killing and a lot of hate and a lot of collapse, really. So, I mean, there are really scary outcomes which are possible.
I do find it interesting that if you look at you know, the image of the Western civilization as the mind and the body and the soul, and you know, in an embodiment, as it were, and then if looking at it in the past, you know, we've had wars on, you know, between countries, you know, well, between members of family to nations to countries, but now, you know, the war is on terror. And, you know, I'm sure most of us have all experienced some kind of fear or panic personally in our own bodies. But to have a whole Western civilization where the war is on terror, it's not really specific, is it? So, you know, how do we cope with that? How do we cope with a Western mind full of terror?
Yeah. I thought about that the other day, because I was yesterday I was out in central London with a friend, and we were in by the dome, the Millennial Dome, and there was just a small bang, which was something like I don't even know what it was, but everyone jumped and looked, and it made me realise, just even though it was a beautiful sunny day, unlike it has been for the rest of the year, and you know, people were having a great time, and there were, you know, tourists from all over the world and all over the country there. Really lovely atmosphere. Just under the surface, there is that fear, and people would know, yeah, God, what's that? What have they done now? Etc. And that's real. That dark stuff is there. What do we do about it? Well, several levels, really. Well, many levels, many layers. On one layer, I would say that, well, I spent years obsessing about the war on terror, stimulated by September the 11th, you know, realizing, you know, what the hell are we going to do about this? This is really scary. And for a long while, my focus was on what I called cyplomacy, which was trying to introduce a psychological dimension into our foreign policy, which is actually, you asked about living system, it's understanding foreign policy and international relations as a living system. You know, the traditional way of looking at it was that, I suppose it's a relationship between one king and another, or one diplomat and another, and so on. And more recently, it's the relationship between institutions, like between one foreign office and another. Or a bunch of diplomats in the UN, etc. And all that's true. So, but the way that they've operated traditionally was to have two main dimensions. One was of force, the ability to physically force the other to do what you want, military power. And the second part was transactional. So doing deals, doing trade, legal agreements, contracts, but basically kind of could be Machiavellian level of operation, or could be a, you know, a legal contract level of operation. And now a lot of people would say, oh, that's all bad. It's not bad. It's absolutely fine. Those are real dimensions of the world. But the one that September the 11th made me realize that we were not giving enough attention to was the third dimension. All human relationships have at least three dimensions: the potential for force, transactional. But of course, then there's the, if you like, the love level, the being to being level, the interconnection level, the and also the hate level, the emotional level. And that's the level at which we trust people. We decide whether we trust them or not, whether we like them or not, whether we identify with them or not, whether we want to be with them, whether we feel secure around them. And of course that happens between individuals, but ever increasingly it happens at a mass consciousness level. It always did. You know, you could go back to 15th century England and say, what do you think of the Africans? I think they called them Moors then. And, you know, people would have some idea, but of course, based virtually totally on prejudice and myth, and that very few would ever have met someone from there. Whereas now, this degree to which we're interconnected, you know, both physically meeting each other, traveling to each other's countries, migrating, and so on, we've got the level, and the media, crucially, and the internet, we really have got mass interconnection. Anyway, the point was, I spent years looking at how I thought the solution was simply that we need to have better understanding with the Islamic world. So between the West and the Islamic world, we need better understanding. We need to understand each other, mutual respect, building trust, building confidence in one another, and so on. And if we do that, then it'll all be a happy outcome. Now, it didn't take me long. I mean, that I still agree with that. That's all still true. But there's a big but, and there's a big and. There's a but, that's not enough. And there's a lot more that we need. What I concluded was that our focus in the war on terror was to, for a start, mainly be in a fear state, and to focus with fear upon the other, in other words, the Muslims or the Islamic world, and work out what we need to do to manipulate them to get them to do what we want. And the mechanism was to think through marketing ways of thinking. How do we package and market what we want them to do and get them to do it? Or how do we manipulate the system and so on? You know, there's some validity in those mechanisms, but the way the world is now, that's not enough, and that's not really going to work. And what I noticed was that there was a massive, great, big hole in that you can't really do dialogue and relations with someone else if you don't know who you are yourself. So if you're coming, if the Western world is trying to relate to the Islamic world, and we do that from kind of two positions, those two I mentioned earlier. One is like the last remnants of the old way, which is the we're superior, we're right, we know best, you know, a distorted view of science and capitalism and progress, and, you know, they're primitives and we will manipulate them to get what we want and use power to achieve it, whether economic or physical. They're not going to like that. I mean, that doesn't mean it's wrong, but, you know, there's going to be a backlash from that, and the world is evening out and they're getting a lot more powerful, so they're going to be doing that back, both directly and asymmetrically. So that's not really, we need to operate in that space, but that's not going to be enough. Then there's the other dimension, which is, if you like, the more, a bit like the male and female, like the sensitive man or the position, which is the one of saying the politically correct multicultural self, which is to say, we don't even exist. If you say, who's we? How can you say we? What do you mean British? Oh no, you can't say that. We're just global. And it's like a the self-hating. We hate ourselves. Everything we've ever done is wrong. Everything we've ever done is bad. All men are wrong. All doctors are wrong. All authority is wrong. Christianity is bad. Capitalism is abusive. There is no truth. You must not judge anything unless you disagree with me, in which, of course, you're in serious trouble. And then in comes immigration into that space. And then those people who've come to the West for a better life, whether it be economic or better human rights, opportunity, values, culture, or because they're running away from something that they don't like, if they then arrive into that space and they're told by one group, you're a bunch of foreigners and primitives, the old racist mindset, you can never be a member of our group, but we'll patronize you and pat you on the head and throw you a few sort of, we'll throw you a few crumbs off the table as long as you're good. And then the other group, the second group, are the ones who say, oh, we completely hate ourselves. There is no such thing as Britain or Britishness. We're just a multicultural melting pot in which every culture is celebrated apart from our own. We hate ourselves. We don't exist. And then all these people are actually treated in a shadow racist way. So they're invited in and put on a false pedestal. Oh, you're brown, so you're good. You're special. You're nice. And your culture, oh, we used to oppress it, so we now celebrate it as a font of all wisdom and goodness. And that's racist, actually, and it's really stupid and naive and childish. But that's what multiculturalism does, and it encourages those people to perceive themselves as victim groups who are then given a special status in relation to the oppressor group, and all lots of laws are created so that the oppressor group can't make any criticism or judgment of the victim group, and the victim group are given special laws to give them preferential treatment and so on. And not surprise if you were in that group, not surprisingly, you'd have no respect for the people you've just come amongst. One bunch of them are racists and dominating control freaks who think you're nothing and will never let you join them. And the other group, these days rather larger, are a group of people who've got no self-esteem, who hate themselves and think of nothing. And then probably you're quite poor or on the poor end, so you also meet those bits of society which are really messed up. So into drink, drugs, and maybe you imagine yourself as a taxi driver in a northern city in Britain, picking people up on a Friday night, and all you can see is a load of girls dressed like prostitutes and all the guys drunk, vomiting up their kebabs in the back of the taxi, and then going home to your family who are come from a traditional foreign background, who've still got some culture, who've still got authority and respect and so on. It's not surprising they would reject the space they've come into. So that's a lot of background. My conclusion, what's the therapy? The therapy is that we need to sort ourselves out. We need to finish off these last remnants of the old dominating racist mindset. We are human beings, we are all one, we are all interconnected. Race is completely irrelevant. It isn't practically because of history and geography and so on, but at the highest level, it's irrelevant. And we need to get rid of all of that shadow nonsense, all of that inversion of the old mindset, which has just turned the old stuff on its head. And we need to work out who are we, both me, you, us as a group, as a nation, as a civilization, as a globe. Where are we going? What is right? What is wrong? What is true? What is false? We need to make judgments on a daily basis. Judgments are good, they're not just bad. We can't live in a world of non-judgment. You need judgment as to know whether to eat a bit of chicken that smells a bit funny. You need judgment to work out whether you're going to cross the road when someone looking who's frightening you is coming to you. Is it safe? You need to judge, make a judgment about, what do I think of the suicide risk of this patient? Or can I trust this banker with my investment? So, at the core of it, we in the West need to rejuvenate our identity, our culture, our authority, our wisdom, our sense of right and wrong, our sense of morality, our entrepreneurialism, our balance between the masculine and the feminine, the way that we are living beings, the way that we respond to life. We need to sort out and rebalance our economy. We need to sort out and rebalance our education system. And so at the core of it, Basically, if we're really successful and dynamic and attractive, those people are not going to want to fight us. They will continue to want to come here to join us and be a part of us. And if we can have a society which is both patriotic and self-confident and open to others at the same time, which requires security, both inner and group security, then we're on to a winner. If we close off and get into a them and us mindset, a polarizing mindset, and if we're arrogant or if we're self-loathing, then we're finished.
Well, that was a fantastic, I mean, that kind of summarised everything for the whole of Western civilization there, not just the war on terror. That was almost, is a really good place to end our interview, I think. That really expresses everything that you're trying to do, where you're going, what you're doing with your project in informing and helping everyone. If people want to... If they're just coming across this first time, there's lots of ways they can get your interviews, and from podcasts and websites and Facebook and Vimeo. And would you like to just spell that out at all?
Thank you. Yeah. The easiest way is to go to my website, www.nicholasbeecroft.com. Or you could Google the future of Western civilization, either with an S or a Z, and it'll all come up. We've got, it's all on the website, and it's also all on, there's a YouTube channel of the videos, a Vimeo channel of the videos, video interviews. There are podcasts, which you can find on iTunes, either through my website or directly on iTunes, and a number of other podcast providers. Also, there's a Facebook group, a LinkedIn group. I'd like to acknowledge the huge amount of help and support I've had from a lot of people, not least yourself, providing lots of advice, encouragement and guidance and support behind the scenes. And too many individuals to name, really. Many, many people have been very generous in contacting me on Facebook, Twitter, and just direct by email, offering encouragement and suggestions for interviews, or putting themselves forward, and a lot of really good mentoring in the background. For example, from Don Beck and Martin Root, in particular. So thanks to all them.
Well, thank you for letting me put you in the hot spots, and hopefully we'll catch up again in the near future and see where you've taken it even further. And it is very exciting, and just wish you, I know from all your followers, just wish you all the, you know, we're all behind you and excited what you're coming up with, definitely excited about the book. So let us know when that's going to come out, and well done, congratulations. It's something you should be really proud of. It's amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you.